100 years ago, on December 16, 1913, one of Canada's all-time great diplomats was born. Just like many great Canadians, George Ignatieff's life didn't start in Canada, but the impact on Canada was undeniable. And joining us now to remember his father's contribution is one of his sons, Michael Ignatieff, the former Liberal Party leader, now professor at the Monk School of Global Affairs at the University of Toronto. And as always, welcome back to your former studio here at TVO.
Thank you, Steve.
Well, your dad's memoirs were called The Making of a Peacemonger. And I wonder if we could start the story back in his native Russia. What was going on at the time that you think contributed, when he was a kid, to his becoming a peacemonger?
It's a great question, Steve. He was born in 1913, just before the First World War. The Russian Revolution then just completely blew his life apart. His father was a minister of education in the last government of the Tsar. They lost everything in the revolution. They were sent into exile. They arrived penniless in Britain. They then, by stages, worked their way to Canada. He came over on the Montrose in 1928 to Montreal and then to Toronto. So it's a story of the First World War and the Russian Revolution turning a family's life upside down, and then a very Canadian story of coming here and starting again and starting from the bottom.
At one point, his mother had lost her home, her country, two kids, and had a husband on death row. Did you ever ask your dad at some point in his life how they all coped with all of that?
That's another great question. I did, because I wrote a little book about all this, because I felt as a son I ought to tell these stories or get these stories down before they disappeared. I think the thing I got from my father about his mother was a really indomitable character. She was born a princess. She never cooked an egg before the revolution, and suddenly she loses everything and her husband is arrested by the communists, by the Bolsheviks, confined in a railway car on a siding in southern Russia. And she basically stormed into the office of the local commissar and said, "This guy's done you no harm. Let him go. He's got a family. Save him." And I think that made some difference. And I think she then, you know, went down the tracks to the railway car where he was confined with other people and brought him food and stuff. I mean, she really saved my grandfather's life. There was something indomitable about her that I think gave frightened children, because my father was only 5 or 6, a sense that it's going to be okay because mom is going to fight for us. You know, this kind of stuff is very primal. And I think that helped him through the whole period of the turbulence of the Civil War, which was a terrible time, starvation, killing, violence everywhere. And I think he, you know, it also created a very strong image of Canada. By the time you get to Canada after that, you think you're safe and sound, and he was.
During World War II, he was an intelligence officer in the UK. You know what he did?
He worked at Canada House. His brother worked as an intelligence officer with MI5 and British intelligence. My mother worked in military intelligence in London. This is the Blitz. Bombs are falling on London. My mother and father met in London. He worked for Vincent Massey, who became the first Governor General of Canada. Firewatch.
First Canadian born,
yes.
Governor General.
Yes, sorry, I should have said that. My father firewatched on the roof of Canada House when the bombs were falling with none other than Lester B. Pearson. Mm-hmm. Mike Pearson and my father watched as the bombs fall. If you were a fire watcher, your job was to make sure that if incendiaries fell, you'd pick up a phone and say, you know, the roof's on fire across the way. And they did that for many nights of that blitz. And my father remembers Pearson saying, "This will be the end of civilization if it goes on like this." The horror of war, I think, had a really visceral impact on Mike Pearson. And when you think about, this was the guy who ended up getting the Nobel Peace Prize. My father always believed that it was that experience of total war in London during the Blitz that I think went into his soul and I think created a lot of what we call Canadian internationalism after the war.
Did your dad want to be a soldier?
Yeah, he wanted to be a soldier, but he volunteered for the British because he could volunteer for the British in 1940. But instead, he was taken by Canada House and worked before Vincent Massey at Canada House. You know, Canada House and Trafalgar Square, they were right there the whole war, 40 to 45. I think a lot of Canadians don't realize just how important we were in the Second World War. You know, between the defeat of the British in Dunkirk in 1940 and the arrival of the Americans in early 42, what there was defending Britain was the Canadian Fifth Army. You know, the place was just full of Canadians, and it was a incredible time to be alive. And I think that had a huge impact on my father's sense of Canada's importance.
About the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombs, he wrote, "The bomb had a profound impact on my philosophy and life." In what fashion do you think?
Well, as it happened, my father came home from the war to work for Mr. King, the Prime Minister. He came home in 44. His mother then died in a small town in Quebec. And then he was with his father in August 1945, and they were talking about politics, and Hiroshima and Nagasaki had just happened. And almost the last conversation he had with his grandfather, with his father, was about this new world that had opened up with the explosion of the atomic bomb. And I think my father, again, because of his experience of the Russian Civil War and the Second World War, just had a horror of the violence that war could do. And I think the discovery that we had an ultimate weapon had a huge impact on him, because he then, almost immediately in 45, went to work for nuclear disarmament at the UN, 45, 46. He became a kind of disarmament specialist for the Canadian government right through to the very end of his career. So that atom bomb in 1945 was a catalytic event in his life, I'm sure.
Helped make him the peacemonger he turned into.
I think there's no question, yeah.
You've got us at the United Nations, let's stay there then. Who made the statement in the United Nations on Canada's behalf recognizing the birth of the State of Israel?
I don't know the answer to that question.
The answer is your father.
I'm stunned.
You didn't know that?
I didn't know that. I knew another story because he was in the UN when I was born.
Yes, he missed your birth because of that.
And he missed my birth, and he was rushing out of a big, important meeting, and he met a rabbi in the hall, and said the rabbi wanted to stop and talk. He said, "I can't talk, my son's just been born." And the rabbi there and then gave him a rabbinical blessing. So the very first blessing I ever received was from a rabbi, which I've always found very kind of, you know. But I didn't know that story about moment.
I read it in his memoirs.
That's a very, well, I must have missed that.
He returns to the USSR in 1955 with Lester Pearson after Stalin's death. And I guess this is probably the first time he goes back to what is now the Soviet Union from his original violent departure from the place. Do you know, did you ever talk to him about whether he was nervous about going back or what he feared might happen?
Yes, I think he was. This was just after Stalin's death. It's a totalitarian regime. People get disappeared. I think he had some concern, but he was with Mike Pearson in an official delegation. He thought it was inconceivable that any harm would come to him. But it was very kind of, it had a lot of weird edges. I mean, Nikita Khrushchev, the emerging leader of Russia, took him aside in one of these big old czarist palaces and said, "We know all about you, Count." We know all of, and said, you know, as a humble peasant, I salute you, Count, dripping with irony, and basically took him aside to a window and said, you know, "Why are you working for this two-bit satellite of the United States when you could come back and work for Imperial Russia like your ancestors?" And my father said, no thank you. But, you know, I think he hated the communist regime because he hated tyranny, he hated authoritarianism, and I don't think he was tempted for a nanosecond, but he translated for Mike Pearson in those meetings, and it was important because this was the first meeting by a NATO foreign minister, Canada was a member of NATO, with the new Russian leadership after Stalin's death, and so the Americans really wanted to talk to the Canadians when we got home because we had a perspective on this new guy who was coming up, namely Nikita Khrushchev.
He said he never felt more Canadian than when he was talking to Khrushchev.
Indeed. Indeed.
So he spoke English, he spoke Russian. Anything else?
French.
French as well. Your dad had quite a front row seat to a lot of history. 1956, he's our ambassador to Yugoslavia, the first foreign-born Canadian ambassador. He met Tito. 1960, he works for former Ontario Premier George Drew, who's now the High Commissioner at the UK. 1961, he joins External Affairs. He reports to Prime Minister Diefenbaker. What did he think of Dief?
I think he thought Dief was extremely erratic. But actually, people always associated my father with the Liberals. He worked for Liberal governments. But he actually had a very good time. The person he liked a lot was a man few Canadians now remember, who was the foreign minister under Mr. Diefenbaker, Howard Green. He thought Howard Green was a wonderful man. So he served them, whether they were conservatives or liberals or whatever. He really was apolitical in that sense. But he thought Diefenbaker was, let's put it this way, a very erratic prime minister.
Was
you just never knew where you were with a guy.
Was he ever tempted to run, as far as you
never,
know?
Never
tempted.
Never.
So you two do not have that in common.
No, we do not.
1966, our United Nations ambassador, he votes for Resolution 242, considered one of the all-time historic significant potential building blocks for Middle East peace. Did he ever think that peace would be genuinely possible in that part of the world in his lifetime?
I think he did. I think he passionately wanted peace. He was very proud of his association with Resolution 242. He didn't merely vote for it. With the, you know, Lord Carrington of the UK and Arthur Goldberg of the United States, they actually drafted it. So he felt he was trying to craft some kind of solution. And it was a, you know, I think he just thought it was strategically important. We wouldn't get peace and detente in the world unless we got an Israeli-Palestinian settlement. And I think it would be a source of grief to him now to know that we're still as far apart as ever.
This is almost 50 years later, and we're still kicking this one around.
Absolutely.
Talk to us about his relationship with Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau, because I gather Trudeau was just about set to make him Governor General of the country, and then at the last second, he pulled the offer back. What happened there?
It's the late 70s, 77, 78, and Trudeau is looking at electoral defeat, thinks that if he nominates Ed Schreier, former Premier of Manitoba, to the Governor Generalship.
NDP Premier,
that'll help him in the West. So he had prepared my dad as Governor General, and then they pulled it the last minute to put Schreier in. It's politics, but it didn't help Mr. Trudeau, who was defeated in that election of, I think, 79. Mm-hmm. And so, but it was a blow for my dad. I think remember what we're talking about here. He was an immigrant boy. He came born outside of the country. You know, it would have meant a lot to him to become the first immigrant-born Governor General of our country. That honor went to someone else. But, you know, he got over it. And I remember vividly that period when he didn't get that job and experienced defeat, failure. And I admired him a lot. He came back. He then became, you know, Chancellor of the University of Toronto and had a fantastic time in the 80s fighting cruise missiles and Pershing missile deployments in Europe, which he thought were a danger to the world. So in a way, the fact that he didn't become Governor General actually liberated him in the sense that he could speak up for the causes that he believed in. There are a lot of people still alive in Toronto who remember with affection how hard he fought against the idea of a militarization of Europe that he thought would literally lead to another war.
What did his more hawkish son think of the deployment of those missiles in Europe?
I was against them because they lowered the threshold of nuclear engagement. I've had my hawkish times, but I'm not nuts. And I thought SS-20s and Cruise and Pershing, nobody remembers this now, but there was a period in the early Reagan years where we really thought we were just on the edge of war in Europe again. And so the massive public campaign against those weapons was, I think, a good thing. We didn't know that 1989, the end of the Cold War, was just coming. But at that moment, it seemed dangerous.
He does, as you point out, go to the University of Toronto, and he says he looks forward to academe where, quote, my opinions would not be homogenized in a hierarchical cauldron where I could speak my mind about some of the most important issues of our time. Did it work out that way for him?
Yeah, I think he felt this is where you have to remember the importance of the university to him. He's an immigrant boy, goes to Jarvis Collegiate, Central Tech, comes to the U of T, and suddenly just takes off. He's a Rhodes Scholar at the U of T, big moment of validation. He comes back 40 years later, is accepted, taken in by the University of Toronto. So he felt validated. He felt it was a kind of, he loved, you know, let me put it this way. It was at the University of Toronto that he became a Canadian. And so for him, it was a very emotional place. And he loved being the chancellor. And he also had a platform in which he could talk about international peace and security, the stuff in which he really had a lot of expertise.
They do say, though, that the politics are so petty at universities because there's so little at stake, right?
Oh, yeah.
Did he find that that was the case, too?
Oh, yeah. He would come back and say, these damn professors, I can't believe it. You know, because he'd been used to, you know, the Security Council and places where something really was at stake. You know, if you're arguing about who has common room privileges, you kind of think, you know, he didn't get it. But he understood and loved and valued what universities did. I mean, he was very at home there. And he felt that the university kind of took him back in and recognized him. And I you know, I'm now back at the U of T, and I know what it meant to him.
You work across the road from a building that's named after him.
I do. Right? I've lectured in that hall.
Ignatieff Theater.
Yeah.
What is that like to walk into a room that's named after your dad?
I walk right past a portrait of him, and it's great, actually. It's one of the nicest parts of being at the U of T. The U of T was very good to him. It acknowledged him. Trinity College was good to him. These things matter to a father, and they matter to a son. It's great to have my lectures at the GI Theater.
I actually haven't asked you yet about your relationship with him. How was it?
He was a fantastic dad because he was very physically affectionate. He was very, you know, the hugs. And I remember walking along beaches when I was a child, you know, and we would, by the hour, you know, he'd pick up stones on the beach and hand me a thing, whether I liked that, and then I would put it in, you know, my little bucket, and we'd walk along for hours. I have very close, affectionate memories of him. We had difficulties in our 20s as I was making my way, and we had I think the conflicts that are standard with father and son. But, you know, when he died, I felt that the kind of audience of my life had kind of disappeared. You know, the way a son does, you know, you kind of, he's in the audience and you're kind of living your life kind of for him in some way. And so it took me a while to get over it. In fact, his death was a tremendous blow. He was a good dad in the way that it matters. He always gave me a sense that I counted, that he loved me, that he cared about me, that he never let me down. And, you know, what more can you ask of a father?
Nothing. What year did he die?
1989, August 1989.
So he saw your rise as a sort of superstar journalist, author, professor, but missed all of your political third act.
He missed my political life. He missed a lot. He missed the end of the Cold War. It would have been wonderful. It was sad that he died just before the end of the Cold War, because I think it would have meant a huge amount. It would have been very moving to him to see the Berlin Wall come down, see the end of communism, see the 20th century go full circle from, you know, he's a kid when the Russian Revolution happens, to see the end of that cycle would have been very moving, but it didn't happen, and he died suddenly of a heart attack and is buried on a hillside in Quebec.
He's in Quebec.
Yeah.
I guess far away, it's difficult for you to get back and see him.
Oh, no, I go up there quite a bit. He's buried in Quebec because it's where his mother and father spent the last 15 years of their lives, in a little town in the Eastern Townships, beautiful place called Richmond, Quebec. And so I always will have a connection with that place because he had a connection with it. And it's the place where, you know, they took the Russian immigrants in and gave them a home.
Nice. Well, in 1981, I graduated from the University of Toronto, and the chancellor who gave me my degree was your dad, and that was one of the highlights of my life.
There you go.
So, Michael Ignatieff, thank you for coming in tonight and reminiscing about George Ignatieff with us here at TVO.
My pleasure, Steve.